everyone. It's me, your friendly neighborhood Spider Dan. Patent pending. So thanks for listening. We really love making the content, and we're glad that you're here to listen to it. But if you do want to support us, there are a few ways you can do that. The first one is to leave us a good review. If you leave us a 5-star review or something, it really helps out the podcast, get us more listeners. Of course, you know, subscribing and telling your friends to listen to is probably one of the better ways as well. You can also share stuff on social media. At The Game Brew is our stuff. That's on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and you can also send us topic suggestions and ideas to those. You can also send it to our email, thegamebrew@gmail.com, or you could come and just hang out in the Discord with us. We have a small community of Game Brew fans who are hanging out in there. You just have to go to bit.ly/discobrew. DISCOBREW. And yeah, just hang out with a whole bunch of us. As well as, you know, if you want to support us monetarily, you can go to our Humble Bundle link, bit.ly/gamebrew. And then that will give us a little bit of flow that we can use to make more content, as well as you can help out a whole bunch of awesome charities and that kind of stuff. All right, so I won't talk you off anymore. Enjoy the show. Where'd you get that pickle jar from?
Dude,
I'm sorry. I'm going to cut this out.
Check this fucking pickle jar out.
Where'd you get that from?
It's a Game Brew pickle jar.
Amazing. This one has four hearts on the back because it's an upgrade from a regular beer.
Did Carrie make that?
Oh my gosh.
Carrie made that for me.
That's amazing. That's perfect.
Oh man. That's so cool.
Did it come with a lid?
No. No, because you get rid of the lid because the lid's fucking useless.
Was it full of pickles?
Not unless you're trying to carry your beer with you.
Hello and welcome to episode 57 of the Game Brew Podcast. I am your host, Ian Hopper Richard, and I'm here with Chris Dustin Writes.
Don't take Dart. Can't have.
And Dan Steve Rotz.
I got my baseball bat, you guys. I miss my girlfriend.
And Allison Joyce Vandevender.
Is it because I have Christmas lights in my room? I'm assuming yes. That's why.
No,
you did
it was.
Yes, it is.
Also, okay. Because of the letters you've written underneath the Christmas lights, which is a little bit weird.
And
but moving on.
Hey, the voices told me to do that. I don't know what the problem is here. That's not
boy.
My fault.
Oh boy.
On the first half of today's show, we'll talk about the best creams to use when you've got a really bad glitch. And in the second half, we'll be drinking, eating, and sleeping our way through discussions about survival systems. But first, it's time to fill up our thirst meters with a beer. Oh, wait. Wait. This is when like the little cool down bar is like opening.
Yeah. Ian, come on.
I remember my first time opening a beer.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Chris, what are we drinking this week?
We are drinking a smorgasbord of Magic Hat beers. It's time for the summer, and when I think of the summer, I think of a bunch of Magic Hat beers.
Yes, indeed.
Magic Hat was like, it was the first beer that I liked. It was the first beer. It was like the first time I ever fell
like
in love.
Like fancy beer.
You know what I mean? No, the first beer period that I ever liked. And I very much think of it like the first time I fell in love. Like there will be other beers that I fall in love with, but this one will always be the first.
Well, specifically number 9, right?
It will always be the 9th. That's correct.
Well, and like,
oh, that's great.
They do a lot of really cool different beers, and they always add like fucking rosemary or orange peel or, you know, coriander and
yeah,
stuff like
willing,
that. Like just experimenting with different stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. So, Chris, what are you drinking? Which one are you doing right now?
I'm drinking Guitar Face.
Whoa.
It's a lot lager. It's a single facial expression that transcends words. It's nice. It's a lager. It's better than your average lager, I guess.
Is it? How would you relate it to Yingling, which is the lager?
It's not the lager.
Yo, Gutterface is an amazing metal band name. Just say that next time,
Allison.
I'm sorry,
I didn't want to interrupt Chris. Continue, Chris.
it's a pretty basic lager, but it's very drinkable. It's not too hoppy. It's not too bitter. But it's, it's very drinkable. You can throw them back.
Throw them back.
Like fish that are too small.
Exactly.
That fish is too small.
Nice. Dan, what are you drinking?
So yeah, I'm drinking this one that's a sound check series. It's one they did. It was a bunch of beers that they had like in their Magic Hat brewery, like in the brewery in Vermont. And then they just kind of shipped them out different places. They like made limited release versions of it.
They shipped them out to Boston. mostly just Boston. Sorry.
But yeah, this one is, it's a Vermont style IPA. And it's called Wandering But Not Lost.
Oh, I like it.
Mm-hmm. All those that wander are not lost. Thanks, Gandalf.
True. It's only 58 IBUs, so I'm like, I'm going through it. I'm going to have to get another one soon.
When they say Vermont-style IPA, what does that mean?
What that means is it's brewed for those who saunter, stroll, roam, and ramble on with a song on their lips and no destination in mind. Huge tropical fruit and citrus hop notes give this Vermont-style IPA a refreshing, juicy flavor that pairs perfectly with its extra smooth body, just like mine, that includes wheat and oats.
Well, I imagine it means it's more of like a New England-style IPA, which you tend to be pretty juicy.
Mm-hmm. Super juicy.
Got it. Thanks for all of that. Allison, what are you consuming over there?
I have what I'm just calling my magic mixture so I can fit you guys. But it's really my go-to thing when I just want something that doesn't taste like alcohol at all, which is...
soda.
Which is Mango Malibu Rum. Cool. And Baja Blast. Like, okay.
Nice. Baja Blast.
Let me be super clear.
You go to Taco Bell to get that Baja Blast?
No. It's the summer, so they have it at Sheetz.
Oh, my God.
God bless Sheetz.
Did you just make yourself like a personal size serving of jungle juice and that's
yeah,
where it is?
I mean, basically. I don't know. I really like Baja Blast, and I've been off soda for a while, so this is my treat to myself.
So Allison's going to be playing video games with me real late tonight.
Yeah! I don't have anything to do tomorrow.
Oh, yeah, it's Memorial Day. Memorial Day weekend. Yay. Happy Memorial Day weekend.
Happy Memorial Day, and...
Happy Memorial Day weekend, everybody.
Thanks to everybody that served, and apologies for everybody we lost, because Memorial Day. But
thank you.
Thank you. What have we been playing this week?
Can I go first?
Yes,
this week?
Or no.
Because I know it's been a little bit since you heard from me.
yeah, thanks, Ian.
So... Thanks, Ian.
And no, it's okay.
See, I made a joke, and then he took it seriously on the last episode. I said no, and he was like, "Okay, I'll just skip Dan this time."
I thought it was serious.
I'm so convincing. So I finished a game called The Way Remastered on my Switch, which is it's like a story adventure puzzle solving game. It's 2D. It was really interesting. Story was kind of neat. Basically, it's like a futuristic, you're a futuristic society. Your wife has died, but you were exploring a planet where there was some sort of resurrection thing. So you bring your wife's body, you like dig up your wife's body and try and get it to that planet to resurrect her.
This always turns out well.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Right. But the puzzles were very difficult sometimes. It took me, like, the game itself was probably only maybe like 5 or 6 hours.
What kind of puzzles were they? Were they like
they were portal logic style puzzles?
Logic puzzles. So like,
yeah. The hardest one for me to get through was one where it was like you had to open up these doors. There were like 4 doors that you had to open by sliding 4 sliders into the right position for it to open each like door. Like each one said, oh, it'll turn this door on this way, this door on this way, this one's closed, this one's open.
Right.
So
and you had to figure out
it's like
the correct combination.
You had to figure out the patterns.
Yeah.
And pretty much everyone was like that. And so lots of brain thinking, but I did it.
I'm glad for your brain thinking.
Yes. Did you look at any guides for that, or did you just... You figured it out.
I only looked at one once because there was one thing where it was super frustrating. I can't remember which puzzle it was. I think I've blocked it out like PTSD.
But yeah, it was a but it was good. I recommend it if you do like puzzle games. I also finished Super Hot. So here's the sound again.
Super
hot. Oh, man.
Super.
Wow.
Hot.
Super hot. Which it does have a story mode, and it starts out pretty easy and like cool, but then it gets really more difficult as you get go on. I know Ian was listening to me just swear over and over again as I kept dying
Dan
in the same level a billion
was
times.
Raging pretty hard in Super Hot while I was playing mm-hmm. other difficult games.
Mm-hmm. And speaking of Rage, I did get Rage 2. I pre-ordered that, so I've been playing that pretty regularly, actually.
It's good? Tell me it's good.
It's fun. If Far Cry New Dawn was good and original, then it's kind of like that.
Okay.
So it's basically, it is a sequel to Rage, which I didn't think it would actually be. I thought it would be like a game that was based off of Rage, like the original one.
Yeah.
Sorry. But no, it's like a legit sequel to this game that came out for the Xbox 360.
Yeah.
So I was kind of surprised by that. But it's good. The story's kind of, you know, the story's kind of good. The open world aspect of it has that kind of Mad Max feel because it's by the same developer that did the Mad Max games.
So it's kind of bleak.
So, yeah, it's kind of bleak, but it's also like the open world stuff is kind of boring. It's not a lot of driving, or at least the driving isn't super exciting. There are some convoys that you can attack, but that's really about it.
How's the gunplay? Is the shotgun great?
Sorry. Yeah, I lost my train of thought. Yeah, it's really good. Like this just as a shooter, this game is fantastic. It gives you all the guns feel really good to use. You have these cool powers that you can use where one's like you run up and like force push people away from you. There's one that you jump up into the air and do like a fist slam onto the ground and it like pushes people away.
I saw a video of that. Like,
yeah. Nice. All of the, and it just like, it feels ridiculous and overpowered and just the best. It's very visceral, just kind of like Doom 2016 is. It's the same kind of aspect where it's like, you feel really good whenever you're doing this stuff. The story's okay. It's kind of blah, but the original Rage was kind of blah also. But it's just gorgeous and really fun to play. Like it's not my favorite game, but I'm not hating the time that I'm spending with it. And, the Tim Kitzrow, he's on fire stuff is really funny.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Allison, what about you?
I finished Detroit Become Human. Yay!
Yay! Here's the sound. Woo!
I really liked it. I know I gave it kind of a harsh-ish review when I first mentioned it. And luckily, the game really got cinematic for me, and all the issues I was having with it, just like not immersing me kind of went away. Although there were some plot moments that took me out, all the characters kind of come together and it gets really, really good. And I'm excited to play it through more times because I want to see all the possible endings because it shows you the butterfly effect chart after each mission you complete.
Nice.
So you see, which as a completionist, it drives me insane because I see the shit I missed. And I'm like, what was I supposed to look at to get that part opened, you know, and things like that.
Yeah. Is it kind of like, wasn't it The Walking Dead from Telltale that was kind of like, you did this thing, 50% of people did this thing.
Yeah. Yeah. You could look at the world and you could also look at your friends, nice. Which there's one thing I did that I kind of regretted, I guess. But I felt like it was just very the character. So I went for it. And 0% of my friends did it, and only like 30% of the world did it. And I was like, oh.
I love that. I love that. That's really cool and really interesting phenomenon when you feel like they've developed the character so much that you make character choices that are in line with that character instead of in line with your own personal moral choices. That's cool.
Right. Well, which I guess actually this is the way I delved the character. You could change the way that you're making all of these characters and all of them interact. So maybe this isn't really like the character at all, but it was like my character's story. But yeah, it was really, really good. I loved it. So beautiful. Very, very visually well done.
Awesome.
That's awesome.
Chris?
So I've been really busy this week, but I did have time to play Earth Defense Force 4.1.
Oh my god, yes! Earth Defense EDF! Force!
EDF!
EDF! Me, Dan, and Ian played this earlier this week, and it's just a lot of fun to play. Like, you're basically defending the Earth against these large insects and aliens, and you basically just have all these different guns that can do so many different things, and all these different characters that can do different things, and you kind of progress to get better guns or better skills and that sort of thing. And it's really satisfying, and just like you're killing hundreds of thousands of things.
Yeah. To be clear, this is a very silly game. Like, the silliness meter is turned up to 11 in this game, and it is great.
Yeah, but like it works. It works. It's very satisfying, and it's, as Dan said, it's very, when he told me about it, it's very Japanese and very, like, over the top, and
Everything's over-explained. The menus don't make any sense.
The menus are terrible.
It doesn't matter.
I was going to say, it's a great game to play when you're operating at less than 100% brain capacity.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of like with Diablo 3, where you're just killing tons of things just because you're so overpowered, but, like, there are times where it is hard because they're just throwing so much at you.
Panic mode sets in.
Yeah, because like a lot of the time you're just kind of chilling and just destroying stuff. And then other times you just get overwhelmed with all the hordes of insects and ants and stuff that are coming at you. But it's really satisfying. It's not very deep, but it's satisfying for sure.
Yeah, there's not really a story or anything like that, but... there is a story, but it's you can ignore it pretty easily.
Is there a reason you just drew a sword, Dan?
Sometimes you just want to hold a sword, dude.
I get that. I support that.
Yeah.
I've been feeling sick this week, man. I just want to be sword holding right now.
He's trying to fight his sickness.
Fighting the sickness. Get up. Come on, get down and fight the sickness.
That was a satisfying all right. voice.
Well, Dan is sheathing his sword. We're going to go ahead and sheathe the intro and draw straight into glitches and games. We wanted to call out a couple of instances in games where glitches have either caused great things to happen or bad things to happen or ugly things to happen. So, Dan, I wanted to go first to something that you've talked about before that features glitches heavily, and that's games done quick. So maybe you can talk about... that event and what glitches you find most interesting from it.
So Games Done Quick is like a charity speed run event kind of thing.
Okay, like Extra Life, but specifically speedrunning.
It started in 2015, and it's like its own thing. A lot of the stuff happens on Twitch. It's pretty cool because people will do a bunch of events. It's usually like twice a year or three times a year. I don't know. It happens every once in a while because they just kind of every once in a while, if there's like a big something they want to raise money for, they just kind of say, oh, we're having an event. And then you can watch it and watch some people do stuff real quick. So it's, you know, like people trying to do Mario real quick, people trying to go through Tetris levels real fast are always popular.
I know Ocarina Sonic. Ocarina of Time. There's a glitch that you can do to get like finish the game in 7 minutes or something ridiculous.
Yeah, I think we talked about before a long time ago. We talked about the guy who did Prey. He like finished Prey in like 2 minutes and 40 seconds because there's like a glitch where you can in like two areas you can just skip the whole level by like wall breaking. And then flying through the wall to the end of that level and then going to the next one and then
again, going through the wall and just going outside of the game and then into the end part of the thing there. It's pretty crazy whenever people do that kind of stuff.
Yeah, and I mean, like, so I guess with developers, like, they do that because they're trying to save space on the, like, yeah. Especially, I mean, I guess it's not as much of a thing now, but, like, back in the day, like, they're just trying to save space on the disc or the cartridge. So they would put things, mm-hmm. different levels on the same section, I guess, so you could kind of
right.
Yeah. Well, they actually still do that. And that's kind of one of my examples of glitching that I thought was interesting is a lot of the Destiny 2 DLC, people kind of got to look at before, like the raid, people got to look at that before it was actually released because you could clip through certain walls in certain places and see where they were building that level inside the game.
Yeah.
And like in some cases, even like walk around it before it was opened. So sometimes, like that wall clipping is an important way to get a look, mm-hmm. at things that are coming soon. And I think that also happened, correct me if I'm wrong, but isn't there a way to get to the starting area in Grand Theft Auto 5 if you glitch out and drop onto it somehow?
Like, yeah, because it's like below, yeah. It's below the map somewhere.
Yeah.
And I forget where you have to do it, but there's a way if you like fall through the floor on the map, you can like land in the snowy area where you start,
yeah.
the game.
Yeah.
Which is kind of funny.
It's just kind of cool, yeah.
Because I accidentally fell through the map a lot in that game and didn't find it.
But, you know. Well, it's not in that section. That reminds me a lot of in back when I played WoW a lot, you know, about 10 years ago or whatever, before Cataclysm came out, I remember jumping around Kalimdor, the one of the continents, and going to one of the sections where the new stuff in Cataclysm was going to be. And it was pretty, like, that area was just desolate. It wasn't, there was nothing there. And so, like, they hadn't uploaded any of it yet, but, like, there was just, like, weird, glitchy, like, it would just be flat. Like, there were mountains around and then just, like, a flat area and then, like, just deep holes. And, like, it wasn't really, I obviously was not supposed to be there, but, like, it was just really cool to see what it looked like. A non-landscaped area.
That's cool.
Yeah. I took screenshots. I don't know what happened to them, but...
Oh, I would like to see those.
Does anybody have any instances where glitching worked against them in bad ways?
Oh, so many.
Oh, yeah.
For me, like, The Sims was always, like, the glitches were either really good or really terrible and broke everything for me. So... Mm. And in the Sims, they happened often, like the visual glitches, just because that game, you could edit things so much. Sometimes it just went really wrong with like the characters and stuff. It would like stretch out their necks or limbs and mesh yeah. objects together. They had like a cheat, I'm going to call it that, but it's really just you can move unmovable objects because sometimes like some of the things would just like... your character would get stuck in an object and there was no way to move it because it's not something that should be moved. Like my character got stuck in my mailbox once, which is something that you shouldn't be able to move in the games. And so I had to use that cheat to like move my mailbox off my character because I couldn't play it for like weeks. And I had to Google on dial up. I used AOL search, I'm sure, on dial up how to do that. So, that was one. But I actually broke my game doing a cheat that ended up causing a glitch. Back in the day, you could Rosebud and get a lot of money. Mm-hmm. And
what is wait? Rosebud.
It was a cheat.
It was a cheat.
It was a cheat in the game.
You type in Rosebud.
Yeah, Rosebud, and then like semicolon exclamation point, and for every semicolon exclamation point after Rosebud, you got $1,000.
I remember doing that. Yeah.
Yeah. Back in the day, like in the regular Sims, you didn't really generate that much money. So I guess the game capped you out at 9,999,999 whatever, like 9 million and then a bunch of nines. I can't do it right now. I've had some rum. So anyway, the game would cap you at that, but nobody really knew it because you wouldn't get to that point. Well, I rosebudded really long one night and just capped myself. And I was like, oh, that's as much money as I can have. Cool. Then I bought some stuff. But in order to buy some stuff, I wanted to sell some of my other crappy stuff. And when I sold the crappy stuff, I broke the game because I couldn't have more money. But the game refunded my items. And I couldn't play that game anymore. I had to completely delete The Sims and my save file and reinstall the game. So that made me pretty mad. But The Sims is definitely like the quintessential glitch game to me.
For me, it was always usually something that stopped me from playing it. There was something that happened to me, I think, when I was playing. It was an open world game. I think it was Fallout 3. The first time I played through Fallout 3, I did something wrong. And like I went to a quest out of order. Like too far.
Like you talked to a quest giver before that you were supposed to get that quest. Or
right.
Something.
Yeah. And then it locked me out of doing the rest of the game.
Oh,
and I had already spent like 20 hours playing the game, so that when I got like, I was just like, I can't go on. Like, and I didn't have any other saves. I didn't have anything else I could do. So I had to convince myself that I could start the game over again and get to where I was. And it was just, oh my gosh, it was just the worst. Like just being like, oh my God, I did all of this already.
Yeah. Interestingly enough, that was like one of the games that I thought of. Well, not that one specifically, but Fallout New Vegas. I didn't buy it because I had heard so many game breaking glitches happened and like people lost their save files and got to the point where they couldn't progress because of things like that. I took a couple of years before I bought the game just because of that.
Bethesda games sort of have a penchant for odd, strange, buggy things happening.
Well, and some of them are pretty funny. When Allison was talking about some of the object, I guess, skins or things like kind of going around things they shouldn't, it reminded me of like an issue that Assassin's Creed, I think it was Unity especially, but I think they all have had that, where people's eyes would show up, like their faces would show up, but like it wouldn't have their face on it.
Yeah.
It would just be their eyes and their mouth. And it was just like
terrifying.
It was terrifying.
Can you also duplicate stuff in Skyrim somehow? Or didn't you used to be able to? So you could have like a bazillion, you could make like watermelons auto-populate.
A la Diablo 1.
Yeah, Diablo 1. That was what I was thinking.
Yeah. I think there was something with that issue in Skyrim. But like in Diablo 1, that was just kind of part of the culture.
Diablo 1, it was more like, cheating.
I remember the first time I played Diablo 1, I just popped into a game. And people were like, yo, do you want this gear? And I was like, yeah, sure. And like, gave me the Godly Plate of the Whale, Divine Staff of the Apocalypse.
I remember a glitch in Pokemon that I didn't know about until later, like a Red and Blue.
Yes.
The old man glitch. Is that the one you know?
I was thinking of a different one.
In Viridian City, there's this old bald man, and he wants to teach you how to catch a Pokemon. And you have to do it later in the game, so it doesn't matter that you already know how to catch a Pokemon. You need to talk to him. And then after you do that, you have to surf and get to you fly to Cinnabar. That's what it is. And then you have to surf, and then on the land, touching the water. And when you do this, then you get this glitched Pokemon called Missing No.
Yes, this is what I was thinking of.
Missing No. And I don't know. I think it showed up for different people different ways. But it was like a little bar, and it kind of broke the game in some weird ways. But I remember that was one of the first glitches I sought out personally because I wanted to see it happen after I read about it online. So, yeah. That one was really cool to me because it was weird.
I don't even think I've read about that online. I think like friends in elementary school told me about that.
Yeah, I just heard about that from people.
Yeah, I was on a lot of Pokemon forums back in the day.
Oh, what about the, do y'all remember like the Gandhi thing that we talked about with Civilization, where like originally Gandhi's aggression was sent to negative?
So you could get nuked by
Gandhi. And there was, there was certain like different things that would make it so your aggression would go lower. And then that would turn him into the negative, so he'd be exposed to the most aggressive.
Which is just fabulous.
And hilarious. And like they've kind of kept that yeah. as like a tribute to like the original one, just like where he'll just like, I mean, it's a meme at this point where Gandhi will just fucking blow your shit up.
I also, so I had an experience, this isn't actually a glitch, but it did like ruin a game series for me, and it's kind of a glitch, so I want to talk about it. So when I was playing Final Fantasy X, which mm-hmm. is the one with like Titus and friends, yeah?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes, and Blitzball?
Blitzball. Yeah.
Blitzball.
Yes. when I was playing Final Fantasy X, I got all the way to the very end, and then like the disc had a scratch or a scuff on it or something, and there was nothing I could do. It wouldn't load, no one else I knew had the game, and so like I tried.
Oh no!
I bought one of those like disc genie things that would like buff a layer of the disc off and then rebuff the disc so it would like take scratches away basically, and it like just ruined my games. It like didn't work at all, so I got to that point in Final Fantasy X and then couldn't play anymore, and I basically haven't played a Final Fantasy game since then.
Oh my gosh, we gotta get you back on the horse, brother.
Yeah, yeah. You're missing out on a lot in life without...
You have a Switch, just buy Final Fantasy. Wait, no. You haven't played a Final Fantasy since then. I was going to say buy Final Fantasy VII, but you could just buy 10 and 10 2 on your Switch and play it on there.
Ooh,
is it available for Switch?
Yeah, yeah, it just came out.
I don't know if I could deal with the whininess of that game now, though.
It's just one character's whininess.
Only one character's whiny. Orin's a badass.
Oh, yeah.
And Waka's really stupid, but other than
I like Waka.
Lulu is my spirit animal.
Lulu, you mean boobs, boobs?
Yeah, like I said, my spirit animal.
Is she what you said?
Yeah, she's the doll in
the Moogle doll. Yeah,
the dress made of belts.
Yeah.
No, the only connection I have with that game, Katie's played it like a couple, like a summer ago, I think. And, like I just watched her played it, and it was there was a lot of whininess. Yeah,
but when isn't there in Final Fantasy?
You got that one character every time.
There's always a princess complaining about some shit.
And in this one, it's Titus.
All right. And with that, we're going to wrap up this section. We'll take a little break here. We'll come back. The second half is survival systems and games. So if you made it through the first half, you're still alive. We'll see you in a second.
You want to try again?
No.
No, it was perfect.
It was beautiful.
Welcome back to the second half of the Game Brew Podcast. We are drinking some Magical Hat today.
Mm-hmm.
What did you just crack open a new one, Chris?
Cracking open a cold one with the boys and girls. I'm not sexist. This is Art Hop Ale. It's a blonde ale with lemon peel and mint. I don't like mint, to be sure. But we're going to see how it is.
Go, 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 go.
Here we go.
Go, go, go. Okay.
Well, no,
just
don't,
a little,
don't,
though. Yeah.
We're not in college.
It's not that minty. It's good. It's refreshing.
Mm. Nice. I'm on to Chillswitch, which is a wheat IPA.
Thank you. I was waiting for it.
Hold on. Somewhere on the control board of your mind lies the Chillswitch. With the blink of an eye and the crack of a beer, it's engaged.
Oh, nice.
The earbuds go in, the feet go up, and the chill sets in.
I love that.
What's the beer like?
It's good. It's lighter.
Is it
it's
chill?
A wheat IPA. It's a little bit more IPA. Grapefruity.
Hmm.
But the question is it chill?
Yeah. Like from the last one, yes. Because it is lower IBUs, and it's like, it feels more relaxed. As far as IPAs go, it doesn't bite as hard.
Okay. All right.
Allison, how is the magical concoction going over there?
I'm a little drunk, so we're good.
Allison, is rum your usual go-to liquor of choice?
Yeah, all different kinds of rum, but rum is my staple. I always have some form of rum in the house.
What's when you're not drinking whatever mango thing you have going on over there right now, what are you usually drinking? What's your go-to rum?
My favorite is Kraken, which is apparently no one else in the world's favorite rum, I'm finding out. But I like the pepper of it. I don't know. Okay. It's my favorite.
Did you ever try Sailor Jerry? That was my go-to in college.
That's my brother's go-to. I don't know. I don't like Sailor Jerry as much, no.
Yeah, it was higher alcohol and it had like a cherry flavor.
Yeah, not my thing.
Did you ever try drinking good liquor, like whiskey, instead of rum?
Dan, you watch your fucking mouth. Yeah, Jesus Christ.
I have,
Jack Sparrow would be offended.
I actually did.
Good.
When Ian visited, I went to wasn't that a whiskey bar? That's what we did?
I don't remember, so it must have been.
Yeah, it was. And I literally had no idea what I was ordering because I don't really drink much whiskey. So I got something that wasn't apparently posh enough. And I got weird looks, and that's all that happened.
Oh, it's not posh enough for a whiskey bar.
I remember in college, we used to drink a lot of rum, and one of my favorite things was we would get Captain Morgan's bottles. You could do like a couple little drawings on it to make it look like Captain Morgan was Boba Fett, so we'd have Boba Fett space rum. So we had like, it was a thing in our apartment where we would like line the tops of our cabinets with bottles, and so half of our cabinets were Boba Fett space rum.
That's hilarious.
That's awesome. So Boba Fett, unfortunately, did not survive the original trilogy of Star Wars movies. Yes, we do. He died.
He fell into the Sarlacc pit.
No, Darth Maul died from the Sarlacc pit.
And he came back.
No, Darth Maul did not die. He was cut in half and didn't have legs again until he had robot legs.
So you're saying it's more likely that Darth Maul came back.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Here's why.
Boba Fett.
Here's why. Allison. Lightsabers cauterize wounds.
Yep.
Well, but also that cuts off all of the circuit. Welcome to the Star Wars podcast with Chrissy and Allison. My name's Dan. I will be just continuing to drink while admitting that, yes, it's goofy space magic, everybody.
So it Boba doesn't Fett doesn't get to make benefit sense from goofy space magic?
What I'm saying is that if you fall into the Sarlacc pit, the Sarlacc is a creature that digests things, which means there's some method of digestion going on, probably acid, and you don't come back from acid.
He was wearing Mandalorian armor, though.
He was. I'm just saying, I'm a Boba Fett believer. I'm a believer.
A believer? Not to be confused with believers.
So thanks for hijacking my segue. I don't have another one. So survival. Survival systems. All right. So survival systems are something that's been grafted onto a lot of games. We see a lot of first-person shooters these days that have some element of survival system, thirst, hunger, management of resources of some kind. But it doesn't always add to the game. So what are some examples where survival systems have made game better? And what are some examples where survival systems have made games worse?
Well, first, can we talk about some things that are... What's a survival system?
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
Are you asking me?
Oh, do you want... I'll do it if you would like me to, but you can do it too.
Dan, go. Well,
yourself doesn't really...
So I guess... Well, I mean, so we're talking about games like where... As far as like you have things that you need to do in order to continue playing the game, like drink water, eat food.
There's a system in play where if you don't satisfy the requirements for them, you will die. So like it could be if you don't eat for a certain amount of time, if you don't drink for a certain amount of time, if you go underwater for too long, if you are in space for too long and you don't have enough air.
If you go insane. Okay.
Oh, yeah. Like, yeah. I mean, that's even like
Darkest Dungeon.
Amnesia, the Dark Descent. Or like, there's like, yeah, if you spend too long in the dark, you like start to see things. And
yeah, so it's like a resource management.
So those are some survival systems, and we've seen them around a lot in survival games and elsewhere. Notably, we get these a lot in Fallouts. The Fallout 3, Fallout 4.
Yes and no.
Recent
one. There is a mode that you can choose to have like more survival systems. I would say that the generic game itself does not really have them, because generally in Fallout or in Elder Scrolls games, food is usually used for gaining stamina or gaining health.
It's rads that I'm thinking about in Fallout.
Okay, yeah. Right? Okay,
there's kind of a survival-y system there. And that system, controversial opinion, that system always annoyed me in Fallout, because I didn't feel like it was implemented enough to be meaningful, and I didn't feel like... it just ended up being like an annoyance to me, and that didn't feel fun.
That's kind of how I feel about even when they implemented a mandatory food and water and rad system in 76, where it kind of fell off, was that like it was less of a struggle to get those things and more of just an annoyance. It wasn't like the game wasn't based around that. It was just something that was featured in it, and it didn't really matter. Like at the time where you get a couple levels, like you would just have enough things inherently where you would just survive instead of having to go search those things out.
Well, one of the things, so in Fallout 4, I think it was, you could turn on like the hardest mode,
yes,
which would make it so you had to drink water in order to stay hydrated.
Yes.
Like you had like a thirst system that was in it, but that was kind of the... That was kind of like the, you can opt in to do this.
Yeah,
like you didn't have
to
play the game
that
way. Yes. Yeah, New Vegas did. Sorry, I forgot that one came first, which I should never do again. But I think the RADS kind of system is interesting because it was a way of keeping you out of places it didn't want you to get to.
Yeah.
Or at least not easily get to. And so for me, I think that was more of a less of a survival type thing and more of a, it's like an inconvenience. Like this is a thing that would inconvenience you and keep you out of a place that you're not supposed to go, or make you move faster through a place they didn't want you to be in for very long.
Yeah, it was kind of like a gear or level check, basically.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah, kind of like the underwater, underwater sections.
Yeah, breathing
in games.
Yeah.
Areas. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I kind of liked that about them. They didn't bother me necessarily, but I don't really like it in all games, so I'm not a big survival person.
Well, but you do play Raft occasionally, which is a survival game where you need to manage your hunger and your thirst.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, so I don't like survival games, which is weird because I played like the original popular survival game called The Sims. which I feel like nobody
survive
considers.
Survive your house.
Yeah, nobody considers that one, but if
don't
you
don't
go eat,
in the pool.
Yeah. I've been trapped in the pool for 2 weeks.
If you don't eat, you die. Like these are things that
true.
Happens in
that's
the game.
True. I mean,
there's no toilets here. How do I poop?
on the floor. But like, I really loved that. And there was just something that was really calming about it. And I don't like the stress of most survival games, but I will play them with friends because I enjoy the group atmosphere. And if we're working as a team, it's less stressful and more like team building, I guess. Mm-hmm. I don't know. It's like we're all helping each other. We all have our own jobs and it feels calming to me again. And especially in like Raft, where I can be fishing and Carrie and you are better at stabbing the shark than me, then like everything's chill. And I really enjoy that. But that's the only way I play survival games is with you and Carrie.
Yeah. And that's actually one of the things that I think that survival systems lend themselves really well to is co-op gameplay that isn't forced or necessarily chosen, right? Because the systems are stressful and because you can be more efficient by specializing in tasks, the game structurally encourages you to help out those around you and to do co-op-y things without telling you specifically to do them, which I think is a really interesting form of emergent gameplay. And it can be as simple as coming across someone and being like, hey, I have this food, you are hungry, do you want this food? And then like you're friends forever, and that's that.
Yeah, I definitely feel that in those games where it's I don't always like online games necessarily, especially with randoms, but in an environment like that where you're actually going for the same goal and you're forced to work together, it's kind of a nice thing.
Yeah, I agree. Like, if there are, like, I feel like if that's a set part of the game as a whole and not just kind of tacked on, I think it works really well and can kind of give you that camaraderie. But if it's just kind of tacked on, it doesn't really have as much impact. It's just kind of an annoyance.
Well, yeah, and that's kind of where games like Fallout, where it's like, oh, it's an additional thing. You know, games where it's like, that's not the main gameplay mechanic, is not to survive. It's just like, this is the mechanic of the game is, I mean, let's go to Minecraft, because Minecraft is the originator kind of these sort of games. Or is it?
Yes and no, but like, it kind of made it big.
It was the popular one that really grabbed on, and I think it coined what survival games are today.
Right. So originally there was no, the only thing that was survival about that game was that don't get hit by monsters or jump off of a giant thing and die. Like, that was the original, like, Minecraft whenever it first came out. And
yeah, don't do dumb shit.
I guess when it first came out. Yeah. It was like, don't do dumb things, DDDT, and then you would be fine. But then they added like the hunger system where you'd have to eat food every once in a while, and that would regenerate your hearts. Very similar to,
but like it the hunger, like as far as dealing with hunger, like it was just kind of one of those things, like it was so easy to get food that it didn't really matter.
Right. But I found myself doing I picked it back up today. Actually, I was playing with somebody because we were talking about Minecraft, and I was like, oh, you know what, I haven't played Minecraft in a long time. Let me re-download it onto my computer because it hasn't been on here in like 5 years. And so we started playing it, and I found that she was asking me like, oh, do you want food? I was like, no, I'm okay. I'm just going to do what I used to do, which is where I'm just going to kill myself and then pick up all my stuff again, because I'm fairly close to where I can just pick up all that stuff.
Yeah.
Because that's how I used to do it whenever I played the original version, was like, oh, I'm really close to being dead. You know what? I'm just going to kill myself and then jump back into the same place.
So it's interesting because I think Minecraft has a successful but different implementation of that one survival system in it. Right. And it's sort of a softer system. Like, it's not hard, but what's interesting about that, and I think the role that it plays in Minecraft is that, and the role that it plays sometimes in other games as well, is that it slows down the gameplay loop. It's designed to, like, here's a task that you need to do to sort of get your mind off of, like, I got to go find iron. I got to kill these monsters. I got to collect this. I got to do that.
Right.
And that's really important to the success of Minecraft, is putting people in a place where they don't just focus on progression. They're also focusing on creativity and sort of bending the world around them to what they want it to be, whether that's sort of like a tool, like, you know, making a garden or getting a bunch of animals so you can have eggs or whatever, or something artistic where you just wanted to build a statue or have a special waterfall somewhere for no particular reason. And if you don't have any systems to sort of like slow the thought loop of the player down, I think that Minecraft wouldn't have been as successful. And it's not as much fun when you're just playing to like get the diamonds and have all diamond armor, you know?
That's true. It does, like, feel more rewarding when you're able to do those things after you've also had to survive a little bit, because there's a struggle behind you just being able to do those things, I guess.
Yeah, and that can go the opposite way too. I love survival games, so I could talk about survival systems forever, but one of the games that is really off-putting to me is Don't Starve.
Same,
like, on the one hand, like, I appreciate the economy of Don't Starve in that, like, you have to always be using all of your time efficiently to stay alive in that game. Like, it very much demands of you that you are doing specific things at specific times to continue to progress past the beginning of that game. And so instead of those loops slowing down that game, they sort of made them so short that everything feels super frantic, and that drives me bonkers.
It's one of the games I cannot play. Like, my brother and sister-in-law, if you listen to early episodes of the podcast, you'll hear me talk about Bradley and Jen playing Don't Starve. And they would always ask me, is like, hey, do you want to play too? And initially I was like, yeah, I can do that. But then it got to this point where it's just like, it's just so frustrating because I keep dying over and over again. It's just not fun for me.
I think we played that as a group too. And it was just
a couple times.
I think we played it a couple times, and I just I did not get connected to that game like at all. And there are some really passionate people about it.
Yeah. And it's like, it's because that's the whole point. The game is called Don't Starve because it's like, don't starve. That's the whole point of it. You know? That's not what I want, though.
That was an outstanding tautology. One of the games, and I think a couple of you have played this, that I really love, that I think manages these systems really well, is called The Long Dark. Do you guys know this game?
Yes.
Yes.
Do you all ever play it?
A little bit. I played a little bit of it.
So The Long Dark... Yeah. Oh, sorry.
It's not my forte, but, you know, it's good. Like, what I played, I kind of liked. It was interesting.
Is this the one where you crash from an airplane?
Yeah, your airplane crashes in somewhere very cold. I think they assume it's Canada or something. And basically, it's just, it's some kind of winter that never ends, and it's really, really harsh environment. So you can freeze by just being outside for too long. And they have a bunch of systems that are difficult, and you have to learn about how to manage your body temperature. And like, if the sun sets while you're out exploring, you can get yourself into trouble. Obviously running out of food and water, and there are also environmental hazards. Wolves and other animals can be aggressive, so you have to like be careful. But also, if you are careful and if you are patient and you kind of know how to manage your resources, you can like make the world work for you. It's really interesting, and it's one of the games where I feel like my choices have really mattered in terms of like, do I leave the house right now and try to collect some extra firewood for tomorrow? Or do I put enough on the burner to make it through tonight and go out in the morning? And like, what's the weather like? Does it look like it's going to rain or not rain? Does it look like it's going to be a blizzard or something? Like, it's intense, and it asks you to make difficult decisions. And I like that.
And the difficult decisions are interesting in those games, I think, but I don't know. I'm so much of a like classic video game sort of person. I don't want to have the water levels in Mario be, oh, I have to think about my air usage the whole time.
Yeah, and
you know?
I don't think they should be. Honestly, I think a lot of the reason that survival systems are effective is because there is a punishment for when you fuck up. If you die in The Long Dark, that's it. Your game is over.
Yeah, it's over.
Like, you have to start a whole new game. And I think that sense of dread and that sense of, like, I need to be really careful about how I manage this and what I do is what makes those survival systems seem meaningful instead of, like, an annoyance. Mm-hmm. And so I don't think Mario or... Honestly, I wish the Fallout games didn't have them. I think they're less good because they do have them.
I mean, I think that in some ways survival systems could be used as a logic puzzle. As far as like, okay, how do I get to this place with enough time or with enough air to get to this place so I don't die? And I think in some ways that can be used effectively to be part of a puzzle.
The Metro Exodus games have an interesting function. The Metro games in general, where it's like you have bullets that are two things. They're also bullets that you can use, and they're also currency that you can use to buy things. So it's kind of an interesting, it's like an interesting use of survival stuff where you have to gauge whether or not, do I use this thing to kill stuff or do I use it to buy things so that I might survive in this like wasteland, you know, or out in the stuff.
Yeah, no, I agree. And I think that they also have survival aspects as far as like, if you get hit in the head too much, your mask gets a couple
like cracks in it,
so
right?
Like it's not as effective, so you lose your air faster. But I think they do a kind of really good job with survival, where it's not like it's not hard, but it makes you think a little bit, right? Mm-hmm. I really like that.
I was gonna say, I think Subnautica also did a really good job with its air management system, where they managed to use it as a tool to build tension when you're exploring new places. So that game is like not really scary, but it feels very tense, not because there's like a monster chasing you, but because if you don't get to where you're trying to go, your air is going to run out, and then you could die in that space. And that is like inherently creepy, especially when it's like small corridors or really deep or you're very far from safety. I think they really nailed tension without fear, maybe is a way to put that.
No, that's that's a good way of describing it. I think I like the thing about that game where you can just use a complex system of straws to make sure that you do have air in lower locations.
Yeah, yeah. There's the complex system of straws, and there's like a series of like pods that you can get that sort of refill your air and allow you to get around faster. It's pretty neat. I'm liking me Subnautica, and they're making a new one. They're making a the chili edition Subnautica. Real cold. It has a different
Subnautica ice.
Subnautica ice, yes. But it's like on a frozen planet this time or something, so that's cool.
I don't know, I can't do games that intentionally build stress. Like, I like scary games. I like to be spooked. But
you don't like the stress. That's
I don't like.
Well, but she likes survival horror.
Sort of, but like if I have to eat in the survival horror, it's not as interesting to me as just like, yeah, I guess survival horror. When we talk about survival, it's difficult because I feel like it can fall under a couple different categories.
Right.
So like, yeah. Yeah, I like Resident Evil. I like those kinds of survival horrors. Not the Dead by Daylight or
the jungle
the forest, I think is what it's called.
The jungle.
Yeah.
The jungle.
The jungle. That's the one where there's this guy in a loincloth just chasing you around.
Yeah, there's something.
His name is George.
There's something about these kind of survival games where managing your air or your food and things like that, where it's just like it's too real, and those are things I deal with in my normal life as stressors, and I don't want to deal with them in a video game. It just gives me anxiety and I'm not having fun.
Yeah, right. Isn't that, and that's kind of like, I know you follow my thoughts on that, where it's like video games are an escape.
Yes,
like I don't
want
to do the same thing that I do, which is why Stardew Valley is so fun, is because I don't farm normally.
Yeah,
you don't?
Harvest
but
Moon.
But I'll farm in this video game.
Harvest Moons are some of my favorite games. Like, that's how I am. So I don't really play this genre a ton, but like I said, I'll do it with friends because I like playing games with friends.
And because friendship is magic.
Yay, my little pony.
I'm gonna put a little sound blip behind that.
A sound rainbow?
Say that one more time.
Because friendship is magic.
Perfect. Thank you.
I heard the chime before you even added it.
All right. Well, I think that is going to be it for us this week. Thank you so much for joining us. If you want to talk about survival systems in games, or you want to tell us about your most joyful or hated glitches, please hit us up on the social medias. But we're gonna call it a night. So good night, everybody. Oh, say good night, everybody.
Good night, everybody.
Good night, everybody.
Good night, everybody.
Damn it! So close.
She's ignoring us. It's fine.
She's ignoring us. It's fine. It's fine. I just wanted to talk to Katie, but you just sent her away.
No, I
switched beers.
I'm trying to focus and do this so I can eat food.
Do this. He's got to get back to his barbecue.
Back to the barbecue. Trying to go drink, Ian.
Trying to get some barbecue in my belly.